Hey, what's up, you guys? GiLaw the Sparky here. Happy Roald Dahl Day! Also, it's Friday the 13th. I don't know about you guys, but I love Roald Dahl. I think his books are wonderful for kids and adults alike. They celebrate the joys of childhood while having a cynical edge that takes shots against modern society, be it with greed, snobbery, or children and TV. Oh god, if he could see the modern world now! Naturally, with such a big following, many of his books were adapted into movies. The Witches, Matilda, Fantastic Mr. Fox, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, Twice, The BFG, Twice. Basically, there is an obvious love for Dahl's work. But there's one Roald Dahl movie that, when you really think about this, isn't really celebrated as much as other adaptations of his work. A 1996 stop-motion animation known as James and the Giant Peach. Compared to other Roald Dahl films, or even other stop-motion films, this is a film that tends to get overlooked fairly badly. I'm sure there's an audience for it, and great if there is, but how many people have sat down to analyze this? How many clips of this are there on YouTube? How many stage productions have been made out of this? How many people are still talking about this over 20 years later? I will admit that the book isn't perfect, in fact it's probably one of Dahl's weaker stories, but looking how this movie attempts to fix those mistakes while being a lively movie for kids and adults, you have to wonder, what the hell happened? Well, being that person who likes to stick up for underrated stuff, I'm going to give this movie more attention it deserves. It's time to review James and the Giant Peach, or as I like to put it, the monkey team of stop motion. We open up with James Henry Trotter, who's enjoying life in his Carson lighthouse with his two dosing 60s parents. He's played by Paul Terry, an actor who hasn't really been in anything else since, which is a shame because he really gives a great performance here, especially when you consider his young age and lack of acting experience. If not being in any future films stops him from going down the Macaulay Lohan-Thelman path, then good for him. James is happy because it's his birthday, and as a present, his parents plan to take him to New York. He dreams about what it must be like by looking at the clouds.
That cloud looks like a camel. And that one over there looks like a train engine.
And can you see the tallest building in the world?
I can't find it.
Try looking at it another way.
I see it!
But then, one day...
A terrible thing happened. An angry rhinoceros appeared out of nowhere and gobbled up his poor mother and father. Their troubles, if they had any at all, were over in 35 seconds flat.
Because of this, James has to go and live with his two wicked aunts, Spiker and Sponge.
Get up! You lazy little bug!
Already wasted 4 minutes of daylight.
Wait! How come when Harry Potter has to live with his abusive aunt and uncle, he suddenly becomes the most famous boy in the world, and yet James is overlooked? Come on, James has a scar going for him, where's his half-giant and magic pastel? Anyway, James is forced to be a child slave to his two aunts, who, most of the time, just sit around drinking lemonade and admiring themselves in the mirror.
Just feast your eyes upon my face.
Observe my shapely nose. Behold my heavenly silky locks.
And if I take off both my socks, you'll see my dainty toes.
But don't forget, my dearest Sponge, how much your tummy shows.
Yeah, the book has a lot of rhymes in it, which the film attempts to convert into song. Most of the time it works okay, but then other times, we get this. However, they do keep it quick here, and it doesn't get too awkward. Meanwhile, James takes a break from chopping wood to enjoy looking at his travel book, but the ants accuse him of being lazy and threaten that if he doesn't keep working, the rhino will get him. I must say, I really like what they do with the rhino story here. In the book, it's pretty spontaneous, and Dahl makes it clear that it was definitely a rhino that escaped from the zoo and ate up his parents. Here, The rhino is kept in the clouds, almost like a figure of imagination. Listen to the way the ants put it. They make it sound less like a rhino and more like a car crash, or even a murder.
Stupid, foolish man. Foolish man, always dreaming. That's what got him killed.
And your mother.
Had his head in the clouds instead of looking where he was going.
He never even saw that rhino coming.
That rhino.
And the beast will get you too, if you don't behave.
The rhino is translated very well, from a brief overlooked statement in the book to James's constant fear in the movie. Not of the beast itself, but more a fear of death. It's a very good metaphor that deals with that fear of death, but still showing us in a child-friendly way. The ants not only overwork James, but they also starve him. They're so convinced that everything they do is right, that they can't tell the difference between a microwave and an oven.
There's something special waiting for you in the oven.
No, that's clearly a microwave, miss.
How dare you disagree with us!
James goes into his horrible bedroom and finds himself so isolated that he begins talking to a spider in the window.
Hello there! Where did you come from? You know, you probably shouldn't build your web up here in the window. Spike and Sponge might see you, and they hate spiders. I'll be your friend, though.
My name is James. That's what Mother called me. My name is James. So it's always been.
Yeah, the songs in this are pretty weak. I am aware that Randy Newman is not a popular songwriter in movies, as he can get pretty generic with his piano and chords, and here it really shows. The lyrics get repetitive and kind of obvious.
There's a city that I dreamed of, very far from here. Very, very far away from here. Very far.
But with that said, this is probably the best song in the movie because it feels like James is giving himself some self-motivation. Notice how the ants have never called him once by his full name. It's always something like,
"You lazy little bug!
Worthless little nothing!
You little worm!"
The song ends on a genuinely sad note as James builds his hot air balloon and watches it disappear into the distance. But at the same time, it manages to cheer him up. But the next morning, the ants find the spider and try to kill it. James goes to save it, but not before the movie rips off a scene from Home Alone.
Get it! Get it!
James runs outside and brings the spider to safety, only to come across a mysterious old man who hands him a paper bag of
crocodile tongues. 1,000 long, slimy crocodile tongues, boiled in the skull of a dead witch for 20 days and 20 nights. Add the fingers of a young monkey, the gizzard of a pig, the beak of a parrot, and 3 spoonfuls of sugar.
To be fair, they do match the description of the book. I'm all for magic and using your imagination, but I think we're all in agreement that those are a bit small for crocodile tongues. They look more like radioactive maggots. But still, their powers probably aren't nearly as strange as what this old man can do. Oh god, that eye scene freaks me out as a kid!
Now listen to me, James. Don't let them get away, because if they do, they'll work their magic on whoever or whatever they meet first.
After that, he disappears, and James brings the crocodile tongues up to the house. But unfortunately, he trips, and they all take off into the soil, using their magic on goodness knows what. The ants aren't happy when they find him sitting on the dirt.
We sent you out here to kill a spider!
Not to laze about.
I wasn't lazing about, I tripped.
How dare you disagree with us!
Oh great, they're angry feminists as well. However, it seems that the crocodile tongue magic is beginning to take effect as they suddenly spot a peach on the old tree.
Now you be a good little boy and climb up there and get that peach for your dear aunties.
Can we eat it?
Of course we can. We'll share it. Me and your Aunt Spiker. Start climbing.
Wait.
What? What? What?
It's growing.
The boy?
No, the peach, you idiot. Look.
It's still growing.
I'm not blind, you dolt. I can see it myself.
Oh!
See it grow.
Yan see this as a business opportunity and start charging people to go and see us.
Can we touch it?
Touch it? You want to touch it?
She'll be wanting to taste it next.
Admission refused. This child has too many cheeky ideas.
Go away!
Oh, sweetie, you should consider yourself lucky. If your brother had asked that question, they would have ripped apart his skull like that piece of paper. Angry feminists! James is asked to clean up after the visitors, and you know how I said at the start that this was the monkey team of stop motion? I would be lying if I didn't say that there are some moments in this that give me some serious monkey team vibes. So, while exploring the outskirts of the city, I mean cleaning up the garbage, James comes across the abandoned Super Robots, I mean Giant Peach. Being so hungry, he can't resist taking a bite, and one final crocodile tongue comes into contact. The peach even opens up the tunnel, allowing him to crawl inside. It is then that James's life is transformed by the mysterious... crazy crocodiles? Yeah, I couldn't make that one work. While crawling inside the peach, the magic of the crocodile tongue takes effect, transforming James's body into some very smooth stop-motion animation. He also comes across a team of giant talking insects. And again, some of these characters have so much in common with Monkey Team that it's actually kind of hilarious. We have the Grasshopper, the sophisticated British man who is fascinated with science and facts. We have the Ladybug, the kind, gentle soul who always has some useful tools on standby. Seriously, Mary Poppins would be jealous of that purse. We have Miss Spider, the tomboy female who is incredibly brave but has social issues that cause the others to respect but at the same time deeply fear her. We have the Glowworm, the other female who's pretty much there to provide spotlight and really isn't that important. We have the Earthworm, who is constantly ranting and raving and worships dirt. And my personal favorites, the Centipede, the egotistical, wise-cracking, constantly teasing, smart-ass-lovable jerk who takes control in piloting the peach. Centipede is the best character, even if he dresses like an old angry Irish farmer. Actually, that's probably one of my favorite updates from the book. In the book, the characters are fine, but they're very interchangeable. Many of their lines are showing off their bug traits and saying sophisticated lines like, "Good gracious!" Here, all the insects have striking designs and dress codes that let you know about their interesting personalities. And they all sing a song about why they want to escape from Spiker and Sponge.
It would be wonderful, wonderful.
Again, while not amazing, this is one of the better songs in the film because it gives us an insight to what these characters are like and what their motivations are. Centipede wants to thrill the big city, Miss Spider prefers to live in the darker, more mysterious nights, Ladybug longs for sunshine and nature, while Grasshopper wants
elegant conversation.
Right. Also, he bonks Centipede on the head. Grasshopper bonking Centipede on the head always cracks me up. The song, however, is interrupted when Spiker and Sponge go out to investigate James's disappearance. The centipede is quick to get to work and release the peach from the tree. Like I said, best character in the film. The peach begins to roll down the hill, and the ants get caught in the chase as well. I know they're probably gonna hate me for this, and I usually don't like to draw this kind of attention myself, but what the fuck? This scene is a lot of fun. With James and the insects stuck inside the rolling peach, it gives us some great sight gags. It's less, just the right amount of time, and just is enough inside the peach and else to keep everyone entertained until the peach throws itself off a cliff and into the sea. James discovers his new travel book, which shows they're all off to New York. Centipede volunteers himself as Commodore, while James comes up with an idea to rope in some seagulls, using string provided by Miss Spider. I should point out that in the book, there was a silkworm who also provided most of the string to rope in the seagulls, but again, her personality was very similar to the others, and she barely interacted with them. In fact, there's only one illustration of her in the entire book. Considering how they couldn't give Glowworm much of a purpose in the movie, It was a pretty smart move not to include silkworm for the sake of it. Finally, to lure in the seagulls, the crew need some bird bait.
Where do you expect we're gonna find bird bait out here in the middle of the... Oh no. No! Have you lost your minds? Ah! They've lost their minds! Anything but birds!
Don't worry! I'm right here! No wiggle!
No!
So Centipede tickles him to get him wiggling. I don't think there is ever gonna be a right way for me to put that. James catches a seagull, but they're not quite safe yet.
A school of tuna. They're being sucked into some sort of machine. Take a look!
It's a giant shark!
It seems to have spotted us!
The crew all get together to rope in all the seagulls.
Shake a leg, Belle! Keep your pants on! I've only got 12 hands!
Just as the peach begins to take flight, the shark bites back by using a shark hook to attach itself on. Oh no, not the best character!
They're getting away!
Hop on, James!
Okay, Grasshopper can catch the seagulls. But jumping is still a bullshit power. Wanna know why? Because straight after that, the ladybug flies up with her purse to bash those barking broods in the face.
Hooligans! Hooligans! Degenerates!
Come on, seagull!
Put your backs into it!
Shake your blooming tail feathers!
I love how at the start of the movie, James being used as a child slave is portrayed as a bad thing, and then next thing he and his group are yelling at the seagulls to carry the peach non-stop without any food or rest.
Good sharky. Nice sharky.
Oh look, Miss Spider is using her giant fist, sledgehammer, to whack out the shark hook and free the peach. This causes the shark to jam and combust. As they head off, James finds the time to teach Earthworm a valuable lesson.
You mustn't frighten yourself like this all the time.
Why not?
You'll make yourself sick. When I had a problem, my mum and dad would tell me to look at it another way.
This is another recurring moral that I believe is one more important now than it ever was, and it really is good for Earthworm. Throughout most of the movie, he's constantly paranoid, pessimistic, and panicking. When James tells him to look at the situation in a different way, he begins to take a more positive attitude.
I'm Wonderworm!
You are!
However, the rest of the crew aren't quite feeling it. On such a long journey, hunger begins to take over.
I know where we're going. I don't see how you can navigate without a compass.
Centipede, no! No, Centipede!
It's very hot up here. I'm roasted.
That's it. Stay sane. Control yourself. No. No. No.
What happened to that bird?
Oh, thank you, Miss Ladybug. You really are a lovely lady. The crew begin to get irritable with each other, with Centipede and Grasshopper fighting over food, and the Earthworm getting angsty again. But James points out that they can gorge on their magic peach, and that gets everyone delighted again.
Taste after me!
After you, there is nothing left to taste.
Oh yeah, these two? They've totally got a spoba thing going on.
Biggest puddle of them all, Angel Fangs! She'll just puncture your head and suck out the brains.
That I am saving for you.
Oh, pretty fast, long legs. Oh.
So the crew sing a song about the peach and compare it to other weird foods they've tasted throughout their lives. This is where the songs really begin to go downhill. Not that it's bad, but God is the instrumental repetitive. Also, it's pretty obvious that Randy Newman took the lyrics from the Dahl poem in the book, adapted it into a piano verse, and gave it to whichever one suited best. See how in the last song how there was an effort to ensure that the lyrics backed up the characters' personalities? Here it feels like Using this first, using that first, and using this one.
For dinner on my birthday, shall I tell you what I chose? Hot noodles made of poodles.
I'm a vegetarian. And a rather smelly jelly made of armadillo's toes. The jelly is delicious, but
the team tuck in, and all that's left is for Miss Spider to join in the fun. She doesn't really want to, so Centipede gives her a hand.
They've got that spova thing!
With the crew well fed, everyone goes to sleep for the night, and Miss Spider tucks James into bed. Miss Spider is probably my second favorite character in the film. First of all, her design is great, giving her a balance between creepy looking but still having a pretty face. Even if sometimes her eyes give me other mother vibes. Speaking of parental figures, she's a great mother figure to James. It turns out she was the spider James saved from his aunts, and you can tell she really appreciates that display of kindness. Many other people fear her because of how she looks. Kindness and acceptance is quite rare to her, so she's more than willing to return it when given the chance. Also, the French accent.
You have had a very tired making day.
I don't know why she's French, maybe the movie has a thing for berries, but that accent is hot.
My life hangs by a thread every day. You shut off. Do not think of them now.
But James is still afraid of the rhino coming after him, and has a nightmare about being caught like a bug. Yeah, Tim Burton was a part of this, and if you didn't catch it before, here's when you really see it. Through some pretty creepy animation that makes Spiker and Sponge look like a terrifying Angela Anaconda reboot.
You can't crawl away from us!
They chant in poor James's head like an evil inner voice that makes him increasingly anxious, again reinforcing his fear of death. Things get worse when the team lands
somewhere north! Or possibly very, very far south.
What's your latitude? What's your longitude?
Hey, hey, hey! That's personal!
You incompetent, blithering nitwit!
All right, Hoppy, them straight words. Put them up! Come on! Give me a best shot!
Okay, I still stand by that Centipede is the best character, but I just love watching Grasshopper whack him in the face. And bonk him on the head. The team realize that without a compass, they're most likely to freeze to death. This gets Centipede into angsty sparks mode, and he dives into the icy waters.
The Centipede jumped in!
Good heavens! He's committed pesticide! Oh, this is all my doing!
Don't take all the credit! I helped too!
James wants to go after Centipede, but in order to do so, one of the adult insects has to go with him.
So who's it going to be?
So they jump into the water and wow! These crocodile tongues are so powerful, they can hold their breath and survive the cold. On the way down, they pass some interesting sights. Okay. Down in the ocean, Centipede explores a pirate ship and comes across Jack Skellington! No, seriously, this isn't the first time he's made a cameo in a Tim Burton movie, and it probably won't be his last either. This Skellington is to Tim Burton movies what Stan Lee was to Marvel movies. Centipede takes the object of haste, I mean compass, from Skellington, but finds that it comes with a curse.
I should have worn a belt!
James and Miss Spider finds him being tortured mercilessly, being stretched out to his limits. Okay, I really need to stop this. Hey, a fight scene!
Hey, sailors!
Looking for some cheek?
Pirates won't give up and chase after our trio. So the Centipede sacrifices himself and goes down to fight the pirates alone. taking too long to return though, so Miss Spider bravely jumps back down, only to find... Wow. It isn't until the character is gone that you reflect on the life they brought to the cast and appreciate the real courage. Just kidding, he's alive!
Centipede, I do not know whether to kill you or kiss you.
They've got that spoiler thing! Actually, that might not be the only romance Centipede is involved in.
Sam, sorry.
My sincere apologies.
I just want to apologize.
I just wanted to say...
What I'm trying to say.
That's enough!
So, with the compass ready, the team can get back on track. Centipede crashes for the night as James takes the time to listen to Grasshopper's music. He explains how sometimes his moods influences what type of music he plays.
When I'm sad, it's like this.
Okay, he doesn't play that. He plays a shitty Randy Newman song! Yeah, say what you will about the other songs, but at least they served some form of purpose and had some memorable moments. This is the most forgettable song out of all of them. I can't remember anything from this. Yeah, look at these characters waking up to listen. This song puts me to sleep. They go on worshipping James about how they care for him and how they got him here, which is nice, but it kind of goes without saying, doesn't it? Wouldn't it be better if they had a nice, quiet conversation about this instead of this annoyingly forgettable song? Okay, I guess there's one thing I remember from this. Play it! Oh my god! How is it that these two get a kiss on the cheek and the hand? They get more kisses than Spova, and they're not even canon! Why is it like this? Why was my favorite cartoon cancel like this? I need my fucking Spova kiss, goddammit! The fanline can only please me for so long! You don't even need to make the 4th, 5th season! I just want my canon Spova kiss! Sorry, I just needed to vent there. On the plus side, the team reached New York.
Whoa.
It gets them excited and they prepare to go. But before they can get down, there is still one final foe to confront. But James is filled with determination and runs down to protect his friends while staring death in the face. Earthworm takes James's advice from earlier and gives it to him to use now. James realizes that the fear of death is all in his head, and it isn't until he learns that lesson that they finally reach New York. James is separated from the crew, but his body is returned to normal. He climbs up to take a look at his new surroundings, but something doesn't quite feel right.
Where's the Empire State Building?
Using my telescope for this precise moment, the odds of something interesting happening at that perfect time is as likely as a police officer in New York actually doing his job right.
Oh wait.
Just send us the biggest train in New York!
James is brought down with the piece, drawing a lot of unwanted attention. Just as everything seems alright for James again, guess what happens? Something else comes to cause him trouble. Yep, it turns out that Ant Spiker and Sponge followed him the whole way here. Maybe they used the same shark from Jaws the Revenge. Actually, that does raise a question that is, admittedly, a bit of a head scratcher throughout the movie, and that's the imagery. Don't get me wrong, the entire movie looks great. Smoothly animated, nice colors, and the occasional in-joke. But then you get moments like this. When James looks for something to eat, he finds these tuna heads. Then later when the crew are attacked by the shark, it sucks in a school of them, obviously showing a connection. And then here, the ants show up drenched in seawater. It shows that they were the ones who went after the crew and tried to pull the peach back, but how did they get this shark? How did they build it? Did they buy it off the funds they made on showing off the peach, or did they have it before they took in James? Was it given to them as a weapon, hence why they have the military hats on? Or are they still angry feminists? How did they survive the explosion? Is an image of them indented into a wall that James and Miss Spider find later? You guess where the animators are going with this, but it isn't always executed perfectly. On his birthday, James gets a candle with the boy riding a grasshopper. So is this foreshadowing the scene where James rides on Grasshopper's back to grab the seagulls? Was the candle affected by a crocodile tongue, or was it a real grasshopper? At the very least, it's not just random symbolism for the sake of random symbolism, and you can see that there is an effort to connect these images to the story. Anyway, the ants claim the peach to be their own.
You mean to tell me that this thing is a peach?
It's not a peach. It's our peach.
It's not their peach. The old man gave the green things to me. That's what made it grow.
Disagree with us!
Even the mysterious old man from the start of the film appears in the shadows and demands to let James give his side of the story. Of course, everyone in New York agrees. Gee, if New York really was this perfect, then everyone would want to come, and Emily's genuinely needs to build a wall around it. When James explains his story, no one really believes him, and Ann Spiker calls it all a dream, leading to probably James's best performance in the movie as he gives a passionate speech about dreams.
Those buildings, these lights, this whole city! Somebody had to dream about it first, and maybe that's what I did.
In fact, it's probably Paul Terry's performance that makes this character. I would be lying if I didn't say that James isn't the most fleshed out of characters. Sometimes he can fall into Gary Stu territory, but again, for a young, inexperienced actor, he really puts in a heartfelt performance that makes him very enjoyable to watch. The ants try to keep their cool, but gradually lose their patience. When James refuses to go home, it's the last straw for them and HOLY SHIT! It's all okay though, the insects are here to save the day.
Giant bugs!
Hey you old biddies!
Yep, he's still the best character. James wraps things up and uses Miss Spider's threads to tie them up and take them away, probably to add to the list of weird things the insects have eaten in their time. Everything ends though, and the crew allow the children to eat their magic peach, including Oliver Twist. They set up a cozy little home and live happily ever after. And then the ants get revived, they start an angry feminist war, and we get left on the worst cliffhanger of all time. You can kill me now. So, in conclusion, I really like this movie. And to be honest, even if I didn't know what Monkey Team was and joke about these coincidences, I think I would still enjoy it just the same. The stop motion is great, the acting is great, and the characters are a lot of fun. It definitely has its faults, like the weak songs and trying to use too many symbols that raise some questions, but at the same time, it gives us the right answers when it has to. It adapts well from the book, while still adding its own perspective to be a fun and interesting movie. I would definitely recommend this movie for kids, whether they're a Dahl fan or not. If I could ask one thing off of Disney, it would be to stop shitting out these awful live-action remakes and take a step back, look at these hidden gems that didn't get much notice, and expand on them. This is one of those movies I want to see more of. I want to see more of these characters, I want to see more of the flying peach, and the possible scenarios it could take the crew, or explore the worlds in the book that the movie couldn't quite touch, or better still, give me my fifth fucking season of Monkey Team! Thank you guys for watching this video. Please comment, rate, and subscribe, and be sure to follow me on DeviantArt and Twitter. I'll see you next time, and I wish you all a happy Roald Dahl Day! And Friday the 13th.